I'm Kylie Minogue, and I've just been doing backing vocals with Tony, so make sure you don't miss it on Motormouth.
Boys wanted to do that. Good morning, everyone. Watch this. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good, this isn't it? Time to take register, I think. Now, is Kylie Minogue here today?
She's not here, miss. She's out with that Tony Gregory again. She's been filming. She'll be in later, miss.
Typical. Johnson.
He's Steve in the chemistry Johnson? Lab, miss. Chemistry.
Brilliant. Oh well. He's getting a bit better at it, I suppose. Neil Buchanan.
Oh, good morning, miss. Yes,
morning.
Yes. Morning and welcome to Motormouth High. Now, don't laugh. The uniforms weren't my idea, Gabby's idea. All will be revealed later.
Oh, sorry. Actually, I am here. Morning. But it is true, I have been skiving off for a little while with Kylie, but more of that later. Excuse me. Gotcha.
Oh, it didn't break.
Anyway, let me introduce you to the rest of the members of our class. They're from...
until 11:30 this morning.
Oh.
And the first lesson we're going to be looking at is Shakespeare.
Oh.
In fact, Shakespeare's sister.
Yeah!
And the rest of this morning is going to look something like this.
Have it. Well done, Ratchet. Did you enjoy that one?
Just for you, especially
Thank you.
For you. How are you? All right?
Yeah, great.
Good.
What you're doing, baby, think about faith. Think of the blood that's running round in my veins. You're soft and naked, you're young and strong. My heartbeat races as you aim the gun. And these prison walls can't hold me anymore.
I think this morning's gonna look really good. I like being a teacher, and did you get my joke?
Your joke, Gabby, your joke. Which one was that?
You're not supposed to say that. This Shakespeare's sister.
Shakespeare's sister, yeah, well done. If you'd like to chat to Shakespeare's sister, you want to put a question to them, give us a ring. The number's 0622 600000. And if you're wondering why we're all garbed up like this, that's because later this morning we're looking at school uniform. In fact, one school in particular has got a school uniform quite unlike you've ever seen before.
What's the matter?
I've just got a Shakespeare's sister.
Thanks, Neil.
Right then, coming up, the first of this morning's cartoons, it's Roadrunner. Watch it carefully, and we'll ask you a cartoon question afterwards.
Meep, meep. Meep, 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 meep.
Here's the first of today's cartoon questions. How many ways did Coyote try to catch Roadrunner? If you know the answer, hold on to it. Two more coming up a little later on. Excuse me.
Neil?
I think it's lines for those two. Now, the chances are you've been back at school now for about 4 or 5 weeks, and you probably have to wear a uniform. If you do, you may look a bit like the one I'm wearing, and you wouldn't believe it, but this is the uniform I used to really wear at school. So, good morning, Hazelwick and Crawley. However, there's one school that started this term with a completely different uniform. Morning, Debbie and Gavin.
Morning.
Morning. Just come over here so that we can see this amazing uniform you're wearing. Now, this is the Queen's Park Community School uniform, and it's a tracksuit. That's amazing. We'll look at that in more detail a bit later on. But first, I know you've been looking at sort of school fashion and how that's changed over the years, haven't you?
Yes, we've done a bit on
Baton project.
Right, OK. So what exactly have you looked at? Like, uniforms through the years and so on? OK, we've got more members of their school here with us this morning from Queen's Park Community School. First of all, we've got Naomi. Let's have a look. What's Naomi wearing?
Naomi is wearing a Victorian pinafore.
Uh-huh.
Although it looks quite pretty, the neck rubs and the shoes hurt, and Naomi wouldn't be able to be very active in this.
That's true. Those shoes look a bit clumpy, don't they? Thank you, Naomi. Next, we have Salis. Now, Salis looks extremely smart this morning.
Salis is wearing an Edwardian uniform. And Salis is always complaining that it's itchy and it's rubbing, and he just looks plain silly.
Looks quite smart, though. Looks quite smart. Thank you very much. Next, we have Dion. What's Dion wearing?
Dion is wearing a gym slip, a 1930s gym slip. As you can see, the shoes are not very nice. The gym slip is not very comfortable and flattering.
It's quite smart, though, with the tie and so on, isn't it? Thank you, Dion. Next, we have Lennox.
Lennox is wearing a 1940s uniform, a bit like the ones we wear today.
Yeah.
Apart from the socks are long and the trousers are short. And what do you think of his legs?
Yes, very nice cap as well. Thank you very much, Lennox. Finally, we have Kalpner. Now, this looks quite familiar.
Kalpner is wearing a modern-day uniform that you'd see today. It's just a blazer, shirt and tie. And I'm really glad that I'm not wearing something like this.
That's something very familiar, isn't it? OK, well, the latest development in a uniform is the uniform from your school, Queen's Park Community College. So, Debbie, just give us a quick twirl on this one. If you'd like to just wander down the catwalk for us. Gavin?
Well, as you can see, this is the QPCS uniform. And it is a tracksuit. And it's nice looking and it's comfortable.
OK, and what's she got there? She's got a baseball jacket and tracksuit bottoms. That's a great uniform, because you could almost wear the jacket at the weekend, couldn't you, really? OK, well, I know your teacher's with us this morning, or in fact, your head teacher, Mary Norton. Morning, Mary.
Good morning.
Now, why exactly did you introduce a uniform like this?
Well, Queen's Park Community School was a brand new school.
Right.
So we had the opportunity to rethink the whole position of uniform. And we wanted something that was smart, distinctive, that people would really notice, and the children would be proud to wear so they'd associate positively with the school.
It's a great uniform, but what did you think was wrong with a traditional sort of blazer and tie like I'm wearing?
Well, we consulted the parents, and 100%, well, 99% said, yes, we definitely want uniform. So then we talked about what kind of uniform it should be, and you've heard from the students exactly what they felt about traditional uniforms.
Right.
And we wanted one that the children could really sort of concentrate on their work. They wouldn't be nagged by teachers about, where's your tie? They could really do their work.
Well, you've been wearing it 4 or 5 weeks now, since the beginning of the new term. Do you think it's been a success?
I think it's been a great success. We've had lots of interest from other schools asking us how we did it. The children in the first year have to wear it, but second and third years could go on with their old uniform. They're already opting into the new, so they're sort of voting that it's a success. And you've heard from the children. They really like it. They're proud of their new school, aren't you, Gavin?
Yes.
Good. All right, thank you, Mary. Now, Gavin, I notice on here you've got a logo. Just tell us a little bit about that.
Well, this logo was designed by one of the pupils. As you can see, it's the three trees.
Yep.
That represent the three schools that came together as one.
OK, now what do you think about the uniform? Do you think maybe other schools will take it up?
Yeah, I think it's great.
Good, OK. Well, let's just put that to the test. Let's just ask our studio audience, would you swap your current school uniform for a tracksuit like this?
Yeah!
Yes, I thought perhaps they would. Well, thank you all very much for coming in.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
What a fantastic uniform. Well, we thought it'd be a good idea, since we've got the school theme this morning, to show you some of our old school photographs. Tony, come on in. He's been hiding this from
us
all week.
You'll see why I've been hiding it in a minute.
That's all right. Ready for this?
Look at that.
Oh.
Young Tony. Look at the haircut, though.
He looks so sweet. All right.
Come on then, Gabby, let's see.
My turn. Thanks very much. Actually, this is the full school photo. But if you watch very, if you look very, very carefully, actually, down in the corner, you can see there I am with my buck teeth before a brace. And that's my brother down there in front of me.
You haven't changed a bit, Gabby.
Where's yours?
Well, you see, I had a little problem. I did try to get a photograph, but I phoned my mum up, and she's only got one photograph of me, and it was taken when I wasn't very well, and she said she wouldn't let me have it, because she said, I don't want anyone to see my son when he wasn't very well. Honestly.
Get away with it, though.
I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll sing you my school song as a forfeit.
No, please.
Thank you.
Gaudiamus igitur Jul.
Neil.
Neston.
I think to prevent Neil singing any more, we'll get on with some of your letters. And there's a great letter that's come in here. This is from Melanie Watkins, and she lives in Gloucestershire. And it's a sort of, well, sort of like a photo story, really. It starts over on the left-hand side. There's me, and I'm saying, what nice hair.
Says Tony.
If only.
He says.
Ooh.
He exclaimed.
Do you think I've got nits?
Gabby said alarmingly.
Yum burp slurp.
Said Neil rudely.
It's torture,
said Steve, and the audience replied...
Yes, sir, yeah!
Not rehearsed at all.
No, exactly.
Wonderful. We should go into the film business. Craig Postgate has sent us in this smashing ghetto blaster he's made for us, and watch this. All you have to do is switch it on, and you get...
Gaudium a signature.
Thank you. Thanks a lot,
Neil. Thank you.
Neil. Sorry.
I don't know why you're telling him to shut up. You've got to hear you singing later. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much.
I've got a lovely letter. Actually, I'm going to do this one first.
All right.
Last week, you said to send in facts about me. And Kirsty Jones has. And she says her favourite food is salad cream. Her favourite pop star is Jason Donovan. Her ambition is to scream like Wendy James. And she says her worst pop star is Matt Goss. Yuck. She's written, yeah. And actually, there's a picture of her there as well. It's a lovely picture. Great, keep sending those in.
OK, I've got a couple of joke books here. These have been sent in by Rasminda Rajo. She's age 12 from Coventry. And there's a good one in here. I hope I can find it. Right, here it is. What do you call a woodpecker with no beak?
I don't know.
Headbanger.
Oh.
And just one quick one. Do you know the joke about the butter, Neil?
No.
I better not tell you. Lonely spread it.
Oh.
I'm sorry.
Keep your letters coming in. We do enjoy them and we try to read out as many as we can. The address, of course, on the old blackboard is Motormouth 2, P.O. Box 1,
Maids.
Neil.
Sorry.
Maidstone, Kent, ME14, 5LL.
This lot here because it may be their last meal. So how about a bit of entertainment? So a big hand. Thank you, Ratchet. Yes, not one of your hands. For Jim, the Jolly Jester.
Yes.
Just before you start. I hope you're going to do better than the last guy because he died a death, didn't he? Yes.
My liege, fear not. I have elephants that can juggle.
Yeah.
I have dinosaurs that can ice skate.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I have pigs that can fly and birds
brilliant.
That can't.
Yeah, brilliant.
I have lions that can do acrobatics.
Ratchet's calling. There's something wrong with the new machine.
New machine? Oh, no, just about got gone.
I got rid of him.
Lady, how forceful you are.
Oh, thank you.
You have my heart, my lady. A dominating woman. Oh, you are my joy. You are my
yes,
flower. Your
you.
Eyes
thank
are
you.
Like two
thank
jewels.
You,
your teeth sparkle
James.
Like diamonds.
James, thank you very much. I mean, it's lovely having you flattering me like this.
I know.
Unfortunately, there aren't many jesters around these days, are there?
No, my lady.
300 years ago, there were?
Well, even 400 years ago, there were. We were. I was everywhere, my lady.
You were.
I was. Oh, my role was. It was omnipresent. I did millions and millions of things. I cast off evil spirits. I did. Yes, because they were very, 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 very superstitious in the olden days. They were very jealous. They believed in all sorts of strange things. And if a jester insulted you, it would bring you good luck. So, my lady, if I was to call you Flabby Gabby or...
Oh, thank you.
Or Freckle Face or...
Oh, thank you.
Knobbly Knees. In fact,
yes.
I'm bringing you good luck for many years.
Oh, well, keep insulting me.
Oh, no, my lady. You
actually,
are a very hard lady to insult.
I've actually got jesters wrong because I thought jesters were purely the fool.
Ah, well, it is true, I am a fool, but in my other guises, when I'm elsewhere, I play the role of Will Summers at the Royal Britain Exhibition in London. Now, Will Summers was Henry VIII's fool.
Yeah.
Now, Henry VIII, as you know, chopped off a lot of heads.
Yes.
Oh, yes, wives, lords and ladies, they're all fair game for the chopping. But Will Summers, who was well known for having the most outspoken, rudest tongue in the land, actually outlived his king. And even better than that, when Henry VIII was lying on his deathbed, gasping for air, it was Will Summers he called for to make him laugh. So there you are, a strong, forceful tongue. Got you places in the olden days.
I'm going to try that myself.
Please do, my lady.
You're talking about Henry VIII's time. Was that the typical costume they wore? I mean, for instance, the hat.
The hat. This is a typical jester's hat, as you can see. It's covered in bells.
Yeah.
The bells, they bring music wherever I go, so you can hear me downwind from miles away. And I have them on the end of my ears, for these are donkey's ears.
Oh, well, I thought they were.
I thought perhaps he did. Well, many years ago, a jester would have worn real donkey's ears. But after 400 years, they whiff a little. So I have these. They are perched on the end of my ears so that everything I hear comes in wrong, so that everything I say goes out wrong. Like that, you see?
He's got the bells on the end as well.
Yes, he's my bauble. Now, very, very important person. This is, in fact, the forerunner of the ventriloquist doll. This is, in fact, Orville's great-great-grandfather.
Oh, can he sing as well?
No, he can't, I'm afraid, thank goodness, but he's very special.
Have you been in touch with our queen, by any chance?
No, alas, there is no role for me at Buckingham Palace, but, my lady, would you be my queen? You are my life. You are my joy. My heart beats only for you. You shall be my queen and I shall serve you till the day I die.
Oh, excuse me. I'm just going to tell them what's coming up in the next part of
Motormouth. My bones shake when you walk into the room.
We're going to be seeing Tony singing with Kylie Minogue. We're going to have the first round. Listen to him of its torture. And plenty more. Don't stop.
Don't stop. You have my heart. You have my heart.
Well, that's the end of break time. As you can see, we've thankfully got out of our school uniforms. Anyway, back to Rasminda Rajo's joke book. There's some great ones here. Oh, where's it gone? Oh, yes. What's the difference between a biscuit and an elephant?
I don't know.
You can't eat an elephant for tea.
Oh, dear me.
OK. Where is it? How do vampires travel?
Don't know.
By blood vessels.
Hey,
And finally, oh, it's gone. I can't find it now.
He can't read.
I can't find it.
Back to school for Tony.
Excuse me.
Yeah?
What's that?
What am I?
Don't know. What are you?
I'm the new game for It's Torture.
What?
I am Maiden.
Sad. Very sad.
Oh, no. See the iron? Where's the Maiden? Right. Welcome to the first game of It's Torture! Now, this is a lovely game, and you'll soon get the point of this one because it's the Ouch! Iron Maiden! Yeah! And Ratchet's been building this so that only one of these will survive. Yeah, come with me. So, you know the rules. After 6 weeks, you know the rules, don't ya? Yes? Yeah. Yes, we do, Stevie. Yes, yes, we do. Right, let's get on with the first question, shall we? The aim of the game is to...
survive!
Lovely! Right, here's the first question. It's coming up now. What is He-Man's castle called?
Green.
That is green, so that's lighter, and that one.
Castle Grayskull.
You are correct. That means red, blue, and grey, they start doing it. Yes! Love it! Right, here's an upstairs question. Are you ready? Do you know what an upstairs question is? I'll ask you the question. If you think your partner can answer it, buzz and let them do it. All right? All right? Right, right, right. All right, Steve? Yeah. Upstairs. What is the proper name for your
tummy button?
That is blue, so answer that one.
Belly button?
Belly button?
Tummy button, belly button, no it isn't!
It's your navel! Lovely! Goodbye, Simon! Right, here's a normal question. Name the third member of this trio. Waterman, Stock, and... Blue, Simon, get it right.
Stock, Aiken, Morton.
Well, yeah, it is Aiken. He did get it in. He did get it in. That means red, green, and grey go up. Yes! Ooh. Right. Here's an upstairs question. Who is the world's highest paid pop star? That is great. That's Shelley. So answer that one.
Michael Jackson.
You are correct. That means... Oh, red, green, and... We're gonna lose some. Get rid of that one. I'll just bang me on the head. Right. Ow, ooh, ow, ooh, ooh. Who stands on top of Nelson's column? That's green. Lisa answered that one.
Napoleon.
Did you hear that? Who stands on top of Nelson's column? Napoleon. Ratchet like that one. It's Nelson, Lisa. Nelson. Right, take green up. Take it up. Is it stuck? Right, it's gone up. Well, I missed it. Right, upstairs question. Who stands to the right of the bride at a wedding? That is Grey. Answer that upstairs.
The groom.
The bridegroom is correct. That means red, green and blue out. Oh, dear. How tragic. We got a winner. It is Grey. They'll be going through to the finals. But first of all, let's go over to the dungeon. Yes. Ah, it's my jolly jester friend.
I'm back, my liar.
How are you doing?
I'm feeling good.
He's feeling hot. He's feeling hot. Right, what have you got for me? You got my microphone? Yes.
Yes.
You got my questions?
Got my questions here.
You got a sandwich for me?
Sandwich. Yes,
you got a sandwich? Got a sandwich. Lovely. Got a joke?
Yes. What does the queen do?
He's quick. Right, come on in, Sophie. How you doing? Are you all right?
Okay.
Who's helped you? It's Shelley. Shelley, come on in. Right. Stick her on the seat. All right, Shelley, she's listening to my greatest hit. How lovely for her. Right, here's a question for you, all right?
Yep.
On a hot day, what would your friend prefer? A cup of tea, a glass of Coke, or an ice cream?
Ice cream.
You think she'd prefer an ice cream? Let's find out, shall we? Right, take that off, Jester. Hello, Shelley. Are you all right? Yes. I'm ever so nervous. Right, on a hot day, what would you prefer? A cup of tea, an ice cream, or a glass of Coke?
Ice cream.
They're both correct! Let me see who win the extra prizes! No! Give her
a prize on there, Watson. All sorts of stuff, take it.
We'll see you again in part two for It's Torture!
It's Torture!
Oh, we've got plenty more torture! We're gonna have to listen to Tony singing!
Yeah, it was just like a real love story. I mean, there was Kylie, there
You're
was
dreaming.
Me, there was the sun, there were flowers.
Good idea.
Oh, it was lovely.
Hello. I'm here to see Miss Minogue.
Have you got an appointment?
Yes, I have, yeah.
Your name is?
Tony Gregory.
Hello, Kylie. Tony Gregory is in reception to see you. OK. Do you want to go up?
OK. Thank you.
I'd watch out for this one, Kylie.
Kylie? Kylie?
Tony!
Kylie, come on down and join me. Here we are. Got you some flowers.
Oh, great.
Just for you. Especially
Thank
you. For
you.
How are you? All right?
Yeah, I'm great.
Good. Come and sit down.
Put these on the floor. Ugh.
Well, I'm normally quiet at home in a TV studio. Here we are. It's home for you, a recording studio.
Yeah, it's getting more homely all the time.
Have you always grown up with music? Did you learn an instrument at school, for example?
Yeah, I was more musical when I was younger, actually. I started learning like rhythm when I was about four. In this class of kids on the glockenspiel and little wooden, what do you call them, wooden sticks?
Oh, xylophones.
Yeah, right? Those, but also they're just like Aboriginal sticks.
Oh,
you just
right.
bang together.
Sounds Must very be peculiar Australian. To Australia.
And then I studied piano till I was about 12, so that's like 7 years or so. And then I learned.
Were you forced to study piano or did you want to?
No, I wanted to. And when I was 12, I said, I don't want to learn piano anymore. And of course, everyone said, oh, you'll regret this. You won't be able to play at parties and things like that. And I could never understand why I wanted to give it up. But now I've figured it out. When I was 12, I was getting into like pop music and, you know, really trendy music. And I didn't think that Run Sheep Run would go down particularly well at a party, you know, or Mozart number 12 or something. So, unfortunately, I gave it up and I've forgotten most of it.
And what about your singing? Because we all know you've been singing for ages and ages. Do you do anything to practice and keep it just right?
Just sing regularly, I think. If you stop for a while, it can be very difficult to get back into it. You might, you know, your range might lessen a bit. And also I find with travelling, it really plays havoc with my throat. So I try and drink a lot of water on the plane and just eat properly, not have too much dairy products. That's not very good for singing. And unfortunately, what I would love to do is be at home and be able to go to my singing guru. He's a guy called Graham Clark. He's just the best. But I can't get to see him, which is a real shame.
Because
he really
do you do
gives
you
confidence as well.
Right. What does he do when you see him? What does he make you do?
He's not. I could tell you a few stories, but I probably
go on,
won't.
Go on.
He's not your regular singing teacher. He doesn't have you doing scales and things. He will have you sweeping floor or...
How does that help your voice?
He's very round. He's sort of backward and going forward. If you're concentrating on what you're singing, you're going to be panicking and all sort of stiffened up. And if you're feeling such an idiot sweeping the floor in this church hall while you're supposed to be singing, you sing more freely. And it actually works. It takes a while to understand this man, but he does make sense.
Mm. Well, obviously it's worked. OK, well, here we are in the recording studio. Let's go and have a look around. Come and show me what all the bits are for. Well, this looks like it's where it all happens.
This is the mixing desk, and this is Pete Hammond, who does most of the mixing for Stockacre and Waterman's Records.
Right.
And Paul, as in Junior Waterman, there. This is Tony from Motormouth. And
Hi, Peter and Paul.
Basically, here there's a track for each instrument that's recorded and each vocal.
Uh-huh.
And Pete, any more information?
Yeah, well, you can sort of fade things up and down, and you can cut them in and out, and you can have them on their own if you want to.
All the buttons flash.
And you can... change the sound of them, put some echo on them, and do anything you want, really. make Kylie sound wonderful.
Can you actually show me something on it?
Yeah, we
can play around.
Come on, Paul, play the tape.
Oh, I recognise that straight away. Okay, but as yet there's no Kylie on that.
No, she's coming in a minute, you see. This is the introduction.
So with each of these different channels on here, you can take an instrument out or add
a bit
more
of
something.
Or... you just want to hear some... You can make it most peculiar.
You can cut me out if you like. Okay, I didn't mean it.
No, right, okay, put you all back. That's everything gone now.
And there it is, back to normal. That's great. Okay, and presumably you can introduce different voices and take different voices out because you wrote backing.
Yeah, we've got backing vocals on here that do all the backing, all the harmonies and everything.
So, some backing vocals and that, I mean, do you think it's something I could have a go at?
That you could have a go?
I'm sure it can't be that difficult.
Yeah, you could probably try, yeah.
Yeah? Okay, well, I'll just go around to the microphone and we'll give it a go. Is that all right?
Yeah, fine.
Great. Well, I'm ready. Just get my headphones on. Ready to go? We ready?
Go for it.
Great. Here it comes. It's going to be good. If I had to do it all again, I wouldn't change a single thing. When it comes to my heart, when it comes to our love, I wouldn't change a thing. What do you reckon? What do you think of me singing?
Do you want an honest opinion?
Yeah.
What did we think of the singing?
Rubbish!
Thanks a lot. Thank you very much. Well, listen, to make up for my appalling singing, we've got 20 copies of Kylie's new album called Enjoy Yourself to give away. We've got 10 LPs and 10 cassettes. Now, to be in with a chance to win one of these, all you have to tell us is what is the name of Kylie's singing teacher? Now, she mentioned it in the film, so it's not too difficult. What's the name of Kylie's singing teacher? Put that on the back of a postcard with your name and address, and also state, if you win, whether you'd prefer a cassette or an LP, and send it to Kylie Competition, P.O. Box 1, Maidstone, Kent, ME14500.
And it wasn't the singing teacher you went to, was it?
Thank you.
Hey, listen, what would you do if you found a rat in your back garden?
I think I'd sit right down here, Neil, and let you get on.
Thank you very much indeed. Well, what would you do if you found 160 rats in your garden shed? Well, if you go and visit the Brinkstow family, that's what you're likely to find, because them and their friend Oliver here, Oliver Cargill, they've got 160 rats in their garden shed. Why? This is Dad, Mick. Why have you got 160?
Well, we breed them for standards, actually, and we show them in rat shows like you would a cat show or a rabbit show.
Ah, I think they're doing a bit of a whoopsie there. We've got a bit of a sticky mess here in the studio, but we'll move on. Aren't they, I was just going to say to you, well, aren't they all sort of smelly and dirty and bubonic plaguey?
Oh, no, they're very clean. They're always cleaning themselves, and they're very active animals. So.
Good. They use their own toilet paper, you see. We come over here. Now, Mandy, you're holding a rat there. Don't you feel a bit squeamish?
No, I don't.
And you like them as pets, do you?
Yeah, I do.
Do they make good pets?
Yeah, they bet they're hamsters, because hamsters sleep at night and they come out at day.
So they're no fun at all?
Nah.
What about feeding them? What do you feed them?
Just the same as... they eat just the same as we do, but for extra, we give them hamster food.
Oh, so any old scraps will do?
Yeah.
That's quite handy, isn't it? Now, Oliver, I know you're a bit of a rat expert. The Brinkstow family, they keep their rats in their garden shed. Where do you keep yours?
In the living room.
In the living room? You must have a tolerant mum. Does she make you clean the rat all the time? And how do you do it? When you go into a show or something like that and you want to show your rat off, how do you clean it?
We have to bath them with shampoo, and then we have to get a scrubbing brush and brush them with soap, and
do the trail of it, and then they have to cut the nails and put, and then they, that we have to put them by the fire to dry.
Fantastic. Well, I'll tell you what, I'll let you into a secret. That's what we do with Tony.
Thank you very much.
Now, Mick, you're a bit of a rat judge. When we've got the shows and that, the rat shows, what do you look for in a prize rat?
Well, mostly the type of rat, the variety, obviously, colour pattern, condition of the rat is one of the most important things. This one I'm holding is a new variety, black-eyed white.
Are they intelligent rats?
Oh, yes, very intelligent. They're very alert. If you walk into a room, they come straight to the front to see who's there and, you know, they want to know what's going on all the time.
So, I know you can go to pet shops and buy rats and come to people like yourself who are breeders. Can you go and pick any old rat out from the street?
No. These are all bred to standards, like I was saying. You know, bred for different varieties, showing purposes, that's what we use them for. They make very good pets, as I was saying. Pet shops, you can get them from pet shops, obviously. Yeah.
Can we have a look at a couple of the other ones? Because you've got different makes there, haven't you?
This one here is an agouti. Now, this one's very similar to the wild rat in variety, but this one's tame, as you can see.
Yeah. Is this the one that's got the babies down the front there? I don't know whether we can see them.
This is the dad to those babies.
Right down at the front there,
the
little babies.
With the babies.
Look at that, eh? Oh. And what about some of the other ones there? What have we got over here?
Right, this is a silver grey, they call this one.
Well, we made a little chirping noise then.
It's a rather large butt.
Wow, look at that.
We call that one a silver grey.
Fantastic. And also, can I have another one?
A Siamese over that side.
Oh, a Siamese. Where's that one then?
Randy's got the Siamese.
This is the Siamese one here, is it?
Yes. Like the Siamese cat.
This is the Siamese one. Fabulous. What makes that a Siamese?
It's the points of the Siamese, you know, for variety. There is a variety very similar to that, which is Himalayan, which is a lighter colour.
They're beautiful. Actually, I don't mind this. I have to say, I don't mind this at all. So if you want to get involved with rats and stuff, is there a society?
Yes, the National Fancy Rat Society.
All right, well, great. Thanks for bringing the rats in. If you've got a rat and you want to learn more about them, then you can contact us and we will give you the address of the Rat Society. The address to write to is, of course, Motormouth 2... P.O. Box 1, Maidstone, Kent, ME14, 5LL. Coming up in part 3 of Motormouth, we've got more torches, we've got Shakespeare's sister, and spooky goings-on in the real Ghostbusters. And I promise you, not a rat in sight. What do you think of that, Robbie? There's something weird, and it don't look good. Who you gonna come for?
Welcome back to Motormouth 2. Now, for the last week, the Motormouth coach has been whizzing up and down the country to pick up that lot from Norwich.
Yeah.
Oh, dear. They're a bit slow this morning. Now, as you know, in the back of the bus, as it goes up and down the country, there's a sort of famous person in the back of the bus. Well, sort of. See what we mean in a minute. And quite a lot of you spotted it this week. But who was the celeb this week, Neil?
It was, and will you please welcome, Michael Jackson.
Yes. So the two people that spotted it were...
Rachel Scott from Whitmore.
And Steve Edwards from Newport Pagnell. Well done, prize pack's well off done. For you.
Yeah, and if you spot the coach, Motormouth coach, going up the motorway this week, write into the usual address, which is Motormouth 2, Spot the Coach, PO Box 1, Maidstone, Kent, ME14, 5LL. And last week's cartoon competition, here are all the correct entries here.
Actually, while Neil's just delving those out, I forgot to tell you that next week there isn't a celeb on the coach.
Oh, yeah.
But there's a password instead, so watch carefully for the password on the back of the bus.
Sorry, yeah, Neil.
Watch out for that.
At least the two winners are to the cartoon competition.
Andrew Brown.
And Roger Norfolk. And the answers were, of course, Old MacDonald had a farm, Thanksgiving Day parade, and 120 feet nose to tail.
Yep.
Brilliant.
Now, you've got to talk about this hat, because when you win a prize bag, you win one of these plus lots of other bits and pieces. I'm going to take this off now because it's time to have a look.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah.
The caricatures that I asked you to send in a few weeks ago. I really asked for trouble here. I did. Come on, then, let's have a look at them. We've also got the winner.
Right, now, we had a fantastic time here looking at these pictures. They were absolutely brilliant. And I have to say, we found out what you finally thought of us. And I'm not too sure whether we like it.
Yes.
Here we go. So look at this one from Matthew Crowther. And I think he's caught our jawlines there.
Especially yours,
that cheek. Thank you. Nice shape of the old face there. He's caught my cheek. Up top we've got Gary Hoffman. This is one of Tony. A few spots on the old nose
thank
there,
you,
Tom. And we go over here, and Tabitha Sims has drawn someone. I haven't got a clue who that is.
Yeah, you need a shave there.
It says Neil on it, so I guess it must
There's another one of Neil over here. This is one that Paul Lyon's done, and quite correctly, he's picked up on the large size of Neil's mouth and the extraordinarily large tonsils. Well done, Paul. Just going up from there, Cheryl Weston has done one of Andrea. Just look at that orange hair, very Andrea-like. And actually, she's done a matching set of, well, it's sort of a Motormouth hair clip and Motormouth earrings. Very, very good, Cheryl, thank you. Dawn Muddyman, she's done Steve and It's Torture.
They're great. OK, I'm going to be very vain and talk about myself. Gabby as a Baby by Louise Lloyd. I love that one. Well, I haven't changed much. There's another one of me, Right Colour Lipstick, Rosa Barra. And Gemma Saunders have done a brilliant one of Tony Gregory going blah, 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 blah.
And the winner...
But here's the winner, Russell Randall,
yes,
of the three of us. Well done.
Well done, Russell. Oh, the caricatures that we shared the other week are on the way to you.
Congratulations.
Coming up, Ghostbusters. Watch it carefully and we'll ask you a question afterwards.
The survivors are eagerly awaiting the reading of the will.
Yes, very good.
Mr. Kingsford?
Yes, Poultrefly?
Did Miss Grizzly leave me anything?
Not a cent.
evening, ladies and gentlemen. And now the whim.
Larry the Plumber.
Larry the Plumber.
Why don't you ever allow us the thrill of discovery?
Sorry, I guess I'm just too good at figuring out mysteries.
Underachieve once in a while, Winston, okay?
Yeah, I'll think about it.
Oh, lovely.
Not even a goodbye.
Let's order from a different pizza place next time, okay?
Wow! Hey, you guys! We're going to the Agatha Grizzly Mansion!
Winston, we already guessed that one. It's on the worksheet.
No, no! This lady's the all-time best mystery writer. She died a couple weeks ago.
Yeah? How? Trying to keep you from guessing her endings before she got them down on paper?
Are you kidding? The reason she was the best is because her stories were the hardest to figure out.
Must have run out of hangers.
Let me do the honors. I loved this lady.
I guess they have trouble saying no to salesmen.
Wow! Right out of chapter 12 in the Murder on the Hoboken Express.
I'm getting strong readings, Peter. There's definitely ectoplasmic activity. Must he do that?
Yes.
Good evening, gentlemen.
Yo, guys, he's talking to us.
Wow! It's just like I thought it would be.
What a surprise. Like kids in a candy store.
May I take your coat, sir?
Well, I don't know. Hey, what the heck? Here you go, sport.
Ever since I took the will out of my briefcase, things have been a little unusual around here.
You may be right.
Besides everything you see here, we've had objects floating in the air. Smoking guns materializing from out of nowhere. And bodies appearing and disappearing.
Sounds just like something out of an Agatha Grizzly book.
Don't mind him, sir. He's a fan. I assure you, we'll get to the bottom of this. I suppose you're all wondering why I called you here. It's this bonus room that really sells this property.
This is where Miss Grizzly wrote all her books.
From the look of this meter, there's still a lot going on in here.
Hey! Wow! This is just like the 1945 Chicago slime creeper room incident.
What the? Hey, I never wanted to be taller. I don't even like basketball.
You know, there's a game show in all this. Nothing terribly exotic in here. See, neatness doesn't count. Even novelists eat fresh fruit and discard the peelings like apes in zoos. It's part of the creative process.
A clue. Raoul's Revenge. I've never read this one.
I think that's because it was never finished, let alone published.
Hey, guys, don't make a fuss. I'm okay, really.
Page 321 is as high as the numbers go. And this one ends in the middle of a sentence.
Possibly the poltergeist activity stems from Grizzly's ghost not wanting to leave until her novel is completed and the killer is named. You might have that one right, Ray. These all seem to be beginnings of the last page, and each one of them makes the killer a different person.
It's all beginning to make sense. The manifestations are probably incidents from her book. She's prompting us to finish the story so that her spirit can rest.
Right. So what we should do then is get some clues from the spectral activity going on throughout the house while I read the manuscript to figure out the ending on my own. Yeah, once we solve the mystery, the ghost should be satisfied. It'll be all over.
The question is, all over for who? Her or us? Not us. Anyway, that's our theory. You got a ghost who needs an ending, and then she can split.
These are the good kind. Chocolate all the way through.
Thank goodness. I thought we were doomed forever to powdered sugar.
Oh, no! I'm a careful shopper.
Egon says the PKE readings are hottest on the second floor, so that's where we're gonna start the search for clues. To the hunt!
The hunt!
I can tell it's gonna be lots of fun.
This is to come later on, and will the Ghostbusters finish the story in time? And put all the ghosts to rest before it's too late. Find out later on. Now, a cartoon question is, what was the name of the writer? One more question to come later on. Now, great trick, this. Just watch this. Don't tell anyone. Ready? Here we go. Back there.
Oh, my, did you see that? Hey, quick impression, who's this? If I had to do it all again. Tony Gregory. Right, welcome back to the next game of... Now, this has got to be my favourite because it's the edge. And these lot are standing on the edge. And when they go over the edge, they land in the pit, which today has my pet wet man-eating shark, Nigel. Yeah! Yes, Ratchet, have you fed Nigel today?
No, master.
Oh, dear, what a shame. Looks like I'm going to have to feed him. Your Teddy! Eat that! Oh! Tuck in, Nige, tuck in! That would teach you for making me be polite all week, it certainly will! Oh, not nice on Ratchet, not nice on Shark, but lovely, lovely laugh! Right! Right!
You know the rules, don't you? Yes. The aim of the game is to survive. They're lovely. I love these lot from Norwich. Really quick. Right, you ready for the first question? What is Curiosity Killed the Cat's lead singer called? Ah! Oh, that's Emma. Hand up. Press the buzzer at the same time. What?
Ben.
You are correct. That means red, green and blue go forward. Closer to the edge. Right, upstairs question. Oh, it's the same again. What is Curiosity Killed the Cat's current single? Green. That is green. That's Max. So upstairs on Emma.
I don't know.
You don't know, do you?
Name a number.
What?
Name a number.
Who are you, James? What are you doing? Shut up! Smart game. Don't talk unless you're told to. Right. It's name and number. Thank you very much. So I think Gray should go forwards for that one. Right. That's this question. Is the moon made of green cheese? That is blue. That is Ben.
No.
No, you are correct. That means red, green and gray. Yes. I think we're going to lose. We're going to lose one in a minute. We're going to lose one in a minute. I'll say this question. What animal would you expect to be called a brook or a brook? That is great. Get that one upstairs, James.
Hello.
Got a big gob, but you don't know the answers, do ya? It's badger. Go on, push straight forwards. One, right. Yeah. What way do you face when you row a boaty? That is red. That's that one, Sally.
North.
North? What way do you row a boat? North? It's backwards. One step forward, we're gonna lose someone. Right, it's an upstairs question. What is the name given to a fox's tail? That is great, get that one right. Emma, it's upstairs. No, sorry, James. No, James is useless, isn't he just useless? It's a brush. Go scroll on grey, go grey, 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 grey. Right, who plays Edmund Blackadder in the TV comedy? That is red, get this one right, Sally.
Rowan Atkinson.
You are correct! That means we lose green and we lose grey! Yes! James! James! Tuck in! Tuck in, Nigel! Tuck in, Nigel! Right! Are you ready? Upstairs question. Is a sea cucumber a plant or an animal? That is red. Get that right. Upstairs!
A plant.
Oh, it's an animal! Oh, dear! It's crazy! We've got a winner. It is blue. They're going to go through the finals. But first of all, let's go over to the dungeon. Yeah! Yeah! Yes. Right. Now, who's going to help me tonight? Oh, no, it's him again.
Please, yeah. I am intoxicated. Right. With all this goo and gems and sharks.
It's lovely to have.
The journey I once took with my
right.
King.
Right. Shut up. Shut up. Go get the prizes. Right. Come in, Neil. Come in, how you doing? All right.
Yeah.
I'm all right, I'm all right. Yeah. Who's your mate? Who's your mate? It's Ben. Ben, get in this seat. Jester, where's he gone? Come back with them prizes. Stick the hat on him. Stick the hat on him. I have to take this off here. Right. Switch it on. Switch it on. Press play. Press play. Look, it's written P-L-A-Y. Right. Play. Right. I'm going to ask you, Neil, come here. Neil, here. I'm going to ask you a very, very personal question about Ben. Do you reckon you can answer it? Yes.
Yes,
he does. Right. Which pet does Ben prefer? A cat, a dog, or a rabbit?
A cat.
Look at a cat. Do you want to shout it louder so we can hear you through the helmet? Do you want
cat!
Kill him! Right, take it off! Take it off! Right, right. What? Which pet do you... I don't know why I should bother asking this. What pet do you prefer? A dog, a rabbit, or a cat?
A dog.
A dog! Both got it wrong. They don't get the prize, it was so obvious. So join us again for the next Gandalf. It's torture.
It's torture.
I don't know how he gets away with it every time, he's mad. Now, these are Siobhan and Marcella from Shakespeare Sister. Thanks very much for coming in.
Pleasure.
What have you been up to recently?
Well, I've been doing lots of interviews in Europe. And I've been getting married.
Congratulations. Thank you. Now, what are you going to perform for us today?
We're doing our new single, Run Silent, from the album Sacred Heart.
Great. If you'd like to go and get ready, thanks very much. Now, if you'd like to speak to Shakespeare's sister, you can call them on 0622 600000. Now, their new single, Run Silent. Take it away.
Thank you.
what you're doing, baby. Think about faith. Think of the blood that's running round in my veins. You're soft and naked, you're young and strong. My heartbeat races as you aim the gun at these prison walls. Do you want it to last? Don't talk of revolution as a thing of the past. I need a hero, are you on my side? Or just a temple for my sacrifice? And these prison walls will have to let me go.
Come to me. I, you better run. 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 Come to me
Welcome back. Now, you remember the other week when we tried to phone Andrea in Australia and she was lost? Well, now we found her.
You didn't have enough 10p's, did you? Well, I was in the bush and, as you know, there are no phone boxes in the bush.
Mrs. Crocodile Dundee.
Well, funny you should say that, Neil, because where we were in Northern Australia is where they filmed Crocodile Dundee. Yeah. There in the Northern Territory, the top end.
So what was it like then?
Well, it was hot, it was dry, it was big. You'll see in the film.
Oh, yeah. Lucky.
Heathrow, London, early Sunday morning, and the beginning of a very long flight. Four meals, two films, one book, and all the Sunday newspapers later, we landed in Singapore, and it was Monday. As it was a couple of hours before the next flight to Australia, I couldn't resist a peek at downtown Singapore. Even though I was very tired, Singapore's Chinatown was so fascinating, I was completely revived. These bicycle sidecars were all over the place. They're short distance taxis, so I went for a quick ride around the block with this man whose name was Johnny Wong. Isn't that a great name? Then another flight where I snatched a little sleep before arriving in Australia, 36 hours after leaving London.
Welcome to Darwin International Airport. The local time is 3:06 on Tuesday morning.
Here I am in North Australia, what the Australians call the top end, the Northern Territory. With me are Tim and Keith.
G'day.
And our guide here in Australia is Murray.
There you go.
And Murray's going to be taking us out into the outback, into the bush, to a place called Eva Valley, where we're going to be spending a few days with an Aboriginal tribe. So, let's go.
OK.
And so we began the long journey from Darwin into the bush. This is the main road out of Darwin, and it goes on and on and on. Eventually, after many hours of hard driving, we turned off the grey tarmac road and onto a dirt road. A bumpy red road that we drove on for many more hours, leaving a swirl of dust behind us and through scorching heat. It's possible to travel hundreds of miles through this countryside without seeing any sign of human life. The more distance we covered, the more I began to realise how harsh the outback is, and the more I began to respect and appreciate the animals and people that survive in such a tough environment. Aborigines lived in Australia 40,000 years before white people arrived. They relied totally on their natural environment and were semi-nomadic, wandering across the country from waterhole to waterhole, hunting and gathering food. They slept out in the open, and when it got cold, they'd snuggle up to a tame dingo dog for a hot water bottle. During the rainy season, they would shelter in caves or in huts on stilts. They had few possessions, tools, spears, musical instruments, fire sticks, and they didn't wear any clothes. Well, they didn't need to. Not in this heat. It was only 200 years ago that the British arrived in Australia. They did not understand the Aborigines and massacred them like animals. So many Aborigines died from the weapons and the diseases that the British brought with them, it was thought that they might die out altogether. Fortunately, despite 200 years of abuse and misunderstanding, the Aborigines have survived. Now many of them live in cities and towns, but an increasing number are returning to the lands of their ancestors, where they lead a more traditional life, like here in Eva Valley. When we arrived at Eva Valley, I was very conscious of being both a Westerner and a stranger. But I soon learned that even though these people live in an isolated and traditional way, they're not entirely cut off from modern life, and sometimes go to the towns to visit relatives or buy food to supplement their natural diet. This lot made me feel welcome instantly and wasted no time in pulling my hair out of its plaits and nicknaming me Bob Marley.
Going bogey now.
When they got tired of playing with my hair, they decided it was time to go bogey, which is their way of saying go swimming.
You might be wondering why they're not at school. Well, it's because they don't go to school. They learn everything they need to know about their culture and history from the people they live with. For many years, Aborigines have fought to claim ownership of their land, and now finally, Eva Valley belongs to the people that live here. Aboriginal ancestral land is very important to them because of their religion, which is called the Dreamtime. This lot will learn about the Dreamtime from stories, songs, and from these spectacular ancient rock paintings. They tell Dreamtime stories about how the land, animals, plants, and people were created. How when the earth was cold and dark, the ancestral beings rose from their sleeping places and created light and life. After supper, people wandered off to sleep or talk, and I sat by the fire with Judy, who told me about the more traditional food they eat at Eva Valley.
What kind of things do you eat here?
We eat goanna.
That's like a lizard?
Yeah, but really big one.
Do you have to go and catch that?
Yeah, and cook it in a coal, hot ashes.
Mm-hmm. Tastes good?
Yeah.
What other kind of things do you eat? Do you eat insects and We all hear in Britain about the witchetty grubs.
Yeah.
Do you eat those?
Sometimes we do, but sometimes we don't. And we eat sugar bag, those honeybee.
Mm-hmm. You eat the bees?
No, the honey.
Oh. What does a witchetty grub taste like? Could you tell me?
Tastes all right. But
chewy?
Yeah.
And do you eat them when they're alive?
Nah, we cook it in ashes.
It's been a long day and now it's time for bed. And this is where I'm sleeping, out here in the open, in this sheet. Well, I don't need anything else because it's lovely and warm, but out here in the Australian bush, under the stars. We were up very early the next morning, and after a leisurely breakfast, Murray, Long Johnny, Kirsten and Gil decided to take me looking for bush tucker. That's traditional food from the bush. Thinking that meant I was going to have to catch a lizard with my bare hands, I was quite relieved to discover that we were looking for wild honey. Murray told me what to look for, a tiny 1 centimetre hole at the base of a tree, which would be the entrance to the nest.
Barry, chicken bag here.
And there it was, the entrance to the nest.
So what are you doing, Murray, now?
What we're trying to do is find where the tunnel is going down in through the base of the tree. Sort of dig up the actual nest itself, because we're looking for a number of different parts in the nest itself. Actually see already there's some bees in down the bottom there, so we're sort of in the right direction to start off with.
They're sweet little bees, aren't they? Tiny things.
Yeah, they actually look nearly exactly the same as a normal bush fly, so you can mistake them. It's only when you get really close to them that you can tell a difference between the fly and the bee. One of the main parts is on the back of their body, they've got a fairly broad leg which catches all the pollen. That's what carries it back to the termite nest and into their own nest.
Like leg warmers.
Yeah, exactly. And in fact, if you have a look at them when they're flying back into the nest and there's no leg warmers on them, then you know that there's probably not much honey.
No leg warmers, no honey.
Exactly.
What's that you found?
This one here, in fact, is part of the nest, right? This here is this is wax. See the wax? See how flexible it is? Mm-hmm. Now inside that there You've got both parts of the nest here.
That's honey.
That's the honey. And the yellow part here is the pollen that they use to create the honey. You just stick your finger right on the top there, get as much as you can, and then taste it.
The best honey I've ever tasted.
Pretty good.
Murray, I notice when you're talking about the Aborigines, you talk with great respect and love. Would you say that perhaps you're more Aboriginal in spirit than white?
Yes. I have been in this country for so long, and my family, in fact, has been here since the early 1800s. And the people themselves are such a beautiful people. And I do spend a real lot of time with them. And I believe that there is a very big future for both Aboriginal people and white people together for the future of Australia.
So what's the position with the Aborigines then?
Well, people are beginning to realise that the Aborigines do have rights, but there's still appalling racism towards them.
Mm. Now, I was watching the film closely. Did you really sleep on that table under the stars?
It wasn't a table. It was a bunk bed. And yes, I did sleep outside in the bush. Although during the night, I went to the loo, crept across the grass, and I saw this long yellow thing coming towards me. And I thought it was a snake. So I ran back to my bunk bed. And in the next morning, I saw this long yellow thing, and it was a hose pipe. I felt a fall.
I'm not surprised. There must have been real scary things, apart from hoses, that you came across.
There was one very scary moment. Our guide, Murray, took me to a place called Barrimundi Gorge, beautiful place. We went swimming out into the middle, and he said, "See those scratches on the rocks over there?" And I said, "Yes." He said, "That's where the crocodiles get out."
Yeah, but they weren't there when you were there.
They were there in the water. I swam with crocodiles. But more Goodness. About that in next week's film. Yeah. And there's going to be a fact sheet about Australia, the crocodiles, Aborigines, all about that. If you'd like a copy of the fact sheet, write to this address: Australia, Motormouth, PO Box 1, Maidstone, Kent, ME14 5LL.
Woe! Woe! And yet more woe! Look, we're all woeing. We're all feeling very miserable. My lady Gabby has left me, and I am all alone. Misery!
Excuse me, sorry about this.
Wait, stop! Hello, or should I say good day, Sheila? Oh, my lady.
Sheila.
I have a crown, but I have no queen to wear it. I have an empty throne. Would you be my queen for just 2 minutes?
Well, I was going for a cup of tea.
Oh, my lady, forget the tea. This is the business. This is it. Put this on. Oh, it's you. You have hair like fire. Oh, I'm hot for you. Come along now. Come and sit on the throne, my lady. Come and sit here. Oh, glorious. Oh, I love your earrings. I'm mad about them. What is your name?
Andrea.
Oh, it's a nightingale song. Give her a big round of applause. We have a queen. We're all happy now. Oh, splendid. My lady, stay there. Stay there, my lady. Here is your royal golden scepter.
More like a rounder's bat.
It's solid gold. It's very, very expensive. And here's an orb.
The rounder's ball.
Very, very amusing. Yes, lovely. She's had living away like she was born to. And here you are, my lady. Here is the solid gold crown. Are you going to stay beautiful when you're queen?
I hope so.
Are your teeth going to shine like pearls forever?
If I go to the dentist.
Oh, glorious. A wit as well. I crown you Queen Andrea of Motormouth. Give her a big round of applause. Well, now, my lady, I will do anything you ask me. Anything you say, I shall do for you, for I am your fool.
Oh, I get it. Now I'm the queen, I can tell you what to do.
Yes, I'll do anything you wish.
Right. For a start, you can sit down and shut up.
I can sit down and... What?
You can sit down and shut up.
Sit down and shut up?
Yes.
I've just crowned you.
Well, you lot can bow. You can bow.
Oh, charming.
Thank you.
Great. Is this the thanks I get for doing a nice service like that? Miserable. I like Gabby much more. I wonder where she is. This one's all grumpy. I never meant to harm her.
Harm her? Oh, no. Harm her. Oh, Ratchet's found me.
What are you wearing that lot for?
Well, I'm hiding for Ratchet because after what I did to his daddy and he's after me. No. Ratchet. No, Ratchet, put down that magnet. Ratchet, I know. Ratchet, please. Help.
Now, that's what I call heavy metal.
It's Joshua! Put that maggot down, I'll kill you! Now, this wonderful device is called the Head
Crusher, yeah. And only... Yes! And only one of these four will survive to the end. Now, you know the rules, don't you? They're very simple. The aim of the game is to...
Survive!
Lovely, lovely. Now let's see if I can do all of this. Right, so on my leg. Who was the Prime Minister at the end of the Second World War?
Green.
That is green. Answer that one.
Winston Churchill.
Winston Churchill is correct. That is red, blue and red. Oh. Here's an upstairs question. In the pop group, where did Frankie go to? Green again. Answer that one upstairs.
Hollywood.
You are correct. That means red, blue, and red. Go on. Another one. Get me some oil. Get me some oil. I'm seizing up. Right. Here's a task test question. How many degrees are there in a right angle? That is grey. So answer that one grey.
90.
You are correct. There are 90 degrees. That degree looks like that. Right. And it's red, blue, and green go up. Right. Here's an upstairs question. How many humps does a back train have? That's red. That's that one then. Red. Upstairs. Go on. As I was told, a back train camel has how many humps?
One.
Nah, what a shame. It's two. What a shame. Yucky. Right. What do the initials ET stand for? That is great.
Extraterrestrial.
Oh, yes, it is great. I thought it was Enterprise Training. No, it is extraterrestrial. Oh, it's down to the last two. Right, here's an upstairs question. I just cut it into my... I nearly chopped my leg off. Right. How do people say good morning in France? That is green. Answer that.
Bonjour.
It's supposed to be upstairs, but I will give you it because it was my mistake. You are great. That is great. Go up one more. One more for Gray. Come on for Gray. Right. I'm going to make this one a downstairs question. Everybody should know this. Right. Are you ready? Yep. How many players are there in a hockey team? That's great. You better get this one, Gray. You better get this one.
11.
You are correct. Oh dear! How tragic! We've lost three. Have we lost three? No, we haven't. We haven't. No wonder they didn't shout out. Oh, it's this armour. Right. Right. Here's an upstairs question. We could have a winner on this one. Let's hope. Right. What runs down the middle of a candle?
Green.
That is green. Answer that one.
The
wick. You are correct. Oh dear! How tragic! The green team are going through to the finals, but first of all, I'm going to try and limp over to the dungeon! Watch my leg. Right, where's my mic? Right.
I pray thee, my lordeth.
Oh,
I am a
no
jestereth. Oh. My lordeth.
Sorry, I'm very sorry.
You done. Shut up, Gabby. Gabby, why have you got another hat on?
I've had lessons.
Another hat, eh?
Where are the people, S?
The people, S? South Carolina. Come in, my dearie. How are you doing? All right. Give us a hat. Ooh. How are you doing? All right.
Yeah.
Did that hurt?
Next
right.
person. Where's
Who's the next
person?
Where is it? Where's it gone? Where's it? Joe.
There
come
we
in.
Are.
That's
down,
called
person.
Joe. Sit down in that chair. I'm going to ask you a very personal question about Joe. All right. Are you ready for this? Can you hear me? Right, I'll talk. Can you hear me, everybody?
Yeah.
Which concert would your friend prefer tickets for? Brother Beyond, Madonna, or Michael Jackson?
Madonna!
Turn around, Will! Turn around!
Quick! Now,
right, shut
yes,
up!
We're ready.
What concert would you prefer tickets for? Madonna, Michael Jackson, or Brother Beyond?
Madonna.
You are correct!
Yes, sir!
And we win the prizes! Oh, no! They go to the finals!
We have Popeyeth. We have more from Shakespeare's sistereth. What do you think of that then?
Useless!
Yeah. You should see me when you're not around. I'm a genius in this town. I'm a queen bee when the coast is clear.
Welcome back, my friends. And now it gives me great pleasure to present with all the hottest news about Her Royal Monogamous and Sir Rick of the Astleys and much, much more besides. Here he is, our very own Prince of Pop, Sir Anthony.
Yes, thank you, Sir F. Jester F. Now, let's get straight into Popeye. A couple of letters that have come into Popeye this week. First of all, Louise Clark. She wants to know what Rick Astley has been up to lately. Well, the answer is, Louise, Rick has been on a US tour in America, and he's currently writing some songs because he's got a new album coming out next year and a new single in a couple of months. Julia Hickson's written to Popeye, and she says, please could you find out when George Michael's bringing out a new single and a new album? Well, you'll be pleased to know he's actually in the studio as we speak, and his new album and single, will they come out next year? Well, some new singles that have come out this week include Fuzzbox, that's called Walking on Thin Ice. Let's just get these around the right way. And Brother Beyond's Drive On. And both of them will be on Motormouth next week. So there's something to look out for. Apart from singles that have been released this week, some new albums. And there's one I'm sure you've been waiting for a little while. It's the new album from Bross. There it is. It's called The Time. A few O's and R's behind me. Now, actually, an interesting piece of gossip about Bross. It was the twins' birthday the other day. They were 21. And you may be interested to know what they gave each other. Well, Matt gave Luke a gold watch and a panda-shaped pendant. And Luke gave Matt, yes, and Luke gave Matt a gold signet ring. Oh! So there we are. That's the new album from Bross. There was also a new album this week from Kylie. Oh, there's Kylie. Well, it includes the singles Wouldn't Change a Thing and Hand on Your Heart. It also has a new track on it, which is going to be her single in about 2 weeks' time. That's called Never Too Much. Because it's not out for a couple of weeks, the video isn't ready yet. So what I've done is I've put together some of my favourite pictures of Kylie to the music.
Why can't you see that I'm still mad about you? Even though I found out about you, I'll always stay forever true.
So there it was. Weren't those pictures lovely, eh? Now, three people who've taken a very close listen to Kylie's album are Emma, William and Emma. Now, you've listened to it very, very closely. William, what do you think of Kylie's album?
I think it was better than the other album that she did. But still, it is very hyped and, you know, not really my style. But it probably will sell because it is Stop Aching and Waterman. And
so you're not Kylie's biggest fan, then?
No.
OK, what about you then, Emma?
I think it's better than her last one because every song seems to have its own style in the album.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it'll sell a lot better than the last
okay.
one.
OK, OK. What about the other, Emma? What did you make of it?
I like it. It is a lot better than the first album. And it's got a lot more variety and it'll appeal to the over-13s more than the first album did because it's not so repetitive.
OK, well, thank you. Now, let's see what you make of these three new songs and videos. Have a look at these.
Of a mask, turn at yourself was a difficult task. Ooh, a taciturn lady, a strange she was, no demon unless closely observed. She screams out.
I love a diva. She's so energetic, isn't she? Now, William, who's first? It's Emma, isn't it? You looked at the Queen video very, very closely. What did you think of that?
I think it's going to be a really big hit because it's got a really good video which goes really well with the song and complements it.
Mm-hmm.
And Freddie Mercury's got a really powerful voice and he puts everything into his singing.
So you're a fan then?
Yeah.
Yeah? Good. OK, William, now you looked at the video from And Why Not. They're a new band. What did you make of them?
I thought they were excellent.
Yeah?
Really new style and like the video, like the lyrics. But I think that their image will be spoilt because they'll be compared to Bross and everybody will say, this Bross was that and Bross was this.
Right. Now then we saw a diva. What did you make of that? Of her then, Emma?
I thought the video had a great atmosphere in it, and I think Adiba's got a really strong voice and she puts lots of feeling into it. Mm-hmm. And I think together they went really well and that'll go a long way.
OK, well, thank you all very much for looking at those for us. And now to Ghostbusters 2. When we left the Ghostbusters, they were trying to solve the story and put the ghosts to rest. Well, you know they're going to do it because they always do it, don't they?
Looks like this is going to take a while. We'd better split up.
Kiss me, you wealthy Jezebel.
But it wouldn't be right, you French cad. I've pledged my troth to another man, a decent man, a man with a really great car.
Forget decency, forget motor vehicles.
That's awful dialogue. What you want? It's a bestseller, you know.
Cheat on me, will you, Debbie? I haven't even made the first payment on that Ferrari.
It's my fiancé. I hope he's not mad.
I just got the tape deck installed this morning.
They didn't even say goodbye.
Read faster.
He wasn't man enough to run you over with his car. He had to poison the milk that you drank.
Where?
The
cyanide in her milk took her quickly.
Ah!
It's true, you know. Cyanide is an incredibly efficient substance.
All this outward grief has given me terrible indigestion.
A little milk always does the trick for me.
That's poison!
Where is that terrible organ music coming from?
You tried to kill me.
Oh, no, I didn't. I forgot. I...
Try to forget this.
Soon, you'll be able to use your little gizmo on yourself, mon ami.
Hello, Winston. Could you read a little faster, please?
Want me to read it out loud to you?
Thank you. That won't be necessary. Just end the mystery before the mystery ends us.
Nothing upstairs. Maybe a ghost in the refrigerator. Won't be the first time. Well, at least I can rule out tropical fruit as a murder weapon.
Peel and dice those vegetables! Stew is tonight's entree!
Sorry, bud. I don't do vegetables. Yes-siree, Bob. A little green pepper can make a meal. Who's coming to dinner? Everybody in Norway? Run, lady. This guy gets nasty with animal substances that don't move. Yeah, I know. Some people hate the smell of garlic, but me,
oh!
I say you can't have too much.
Peter!
You crushed my vegetable, Egon.
I was followed.
Poison my luscious Debbie. You couldn't stand the way she laughed at your ugly car. What? What? I said, please take this gun off my head.
Grizzly got paid for writing this?
Nobody said life was fair.
Wow! I bet you could level the house with that thing.
Ha ha ha, that Ray, always kidding about things like the destructive firepower of major military weapons. Care for a healthful snack while you read?
Thanks, Pete.
Roquefort blue cheese or locale Italian?
Roquefort, thanks.
Good book?
Terrific. I'm almost done, and I think I know who the killer was.
I was the only man who really loved Debbie. When I cooked dinner, she ate like a horse. This was her favorite food. She can't eat this anymore.
Well, among other things she can't do.
If she can't, nobody should. And nobody should do anything else anymore either.
Read faster, Winston.
I'm reading.
Where's the off switch on this thing?
There might not even be a real on switch. There's a chance that this is a spirit manifestation that doesn't work.
But there's a chance that it does.
But there's a chance that it doesn't.
But there's a chance that it does.
But there's a...
Look, can we just pretend that we're going to be obliterated in about 45 seconds, okay? This isn't very good.
That is Debbie's cake, not yours, you jumpsuited ninny!
I'm glad you decided to blow us into another dimension. Maybe Debbie and I can be together there. Be sure you take some cab fare. Your car will probably break down. Then at least I won't have to eat any of your depressing food. This little cracker spread with the liver of a silly goose makes you sad? Yes. Then weep, you fool. Ugh. Ew, ew, ew.
Explosion would go unnoticed at this point.
I know who did it! Holy!
Yes, Winston, it's the usual bomb they put in these kind of cakes. Now, who did it?
The doctor. Debbie ran up a huge bill from all the emergency calls for her severe indigestion from that bad gourmet food. She refused to pay his bill and made fun of his car, so he gave her poison in her last medication.
I suspected as much. Ah, well, at least now we can rest.
Oh, Mr. Zedmore, how could I ever thank you all for finishing my greatest and last mystery?
I say, that's my coat.
You could get rid of the bomb. We just can't see it as a table lamp.
It was a little melodramatic, wasn't it?
My coat disappeared!
Mm-hmm.
It's the last page. And look, this story is dedicated to Winston Zeddemore and his fellow Ghostbusters.
It's the youngest aunt. She had the pocket knife.
Yes, but she bought it from the dwarf at the ballpark.
Maybe it was the home plate umpire. He was pretty testy after he got that foul tip in the face.
Yeah, but he was philosophical about it.
So was the dwarf.
We've just got the confession. It was...
The butler!
The chauffeur.
Now, here's the final question in the cartoon competition. What we want to know is who committed the murder? Who committed the murder in Ghostbusters? Now, what you have to do is write all three answers down on a postcard. Don't forget, we need it on a postcard, please. Send it to the usual address, and next week we'll pick out two winners who will both receive Motormouth prize bags. And you saw earlier what they've got in it, hats, bits and pieces, it's great. Here's the question again. Who committed the murder? On a postcard, please, with all three answers to the usual address, and that is... What are you doing in there?
Just playing around. I'll show you why in a minute. Anyway, right. Let me give you the address. It's Motormouth 2, P.O. Box 1, Maidstone, Kent. ME14 5LL. Now, watch this. There we are, Gungeon in the Dungeon. Why do you need that? Because we've had a great idea. If there's someone who's been maybe annoying you a little bit lately, maybe your older sister's talking too much or a teacher's giving you a little bit too much homework, we want to know. We'll put them in the dungeon and we'll gunge them. So drop us a line to Gungeon in the Dungeon.
Yeah, we'll put them right here, we'll stick an It's Torture t-shirt on them, we'll sit them in the seat, and you know what happens next.
And don't forget, we'll also belt you in, because we're
belt
safety
them in.
First.
Yeah, absolutely. Right. Yeah. That's good.
Yeah. And then you know what happens, don't you?
All the glue.
Yeah, yeah. We gunge them, don't we, Steve?
Yes!
Wrong.
It's torture!
Yes! Hello! Hello! It's the final game! These three or four of the way through, you know the rules, we're running out of time, let's get on with it! The aim of the game is to... survive! Yeah. Are you ready for the first question? Yes? No? Somebody isn't? Horrible smell from up there. Right. Whew, somebody's done something. Right. Did Admiral Nelson suffer from seasickness? Yes, that is red. Answer that one.
No.
Yes, he did. Oh, Sophie, no, throw away. Oh, yes. Right, here's another question. What famous gorge in Somerset is also a common English cheese? Come on, what famous gorge, a common English cheese in Somerset? No, you don't know, do you? It's the Cheddar Gorge. There's a smell of cheddar coming from up there. Right, it's a North God. Is the Norse god Thor gave his name to which day of the week?
Green.
Oh, green.
Thursday.
Thursday is correct. That means you can take somebody else's weight. Neil, whose weight are you going to take? Yes, of course he is. He's taking the red. Goodbye, red. Oh, dear. How red. Question. Great, I love this. Ratchet, chomping.
Yes,
all right.
Master.
Guess what? Who was Dorothy looking for when she set off up the Yellow Brick Road? Follow the Yellow Brick Road. Bang! It was the Wizard of Oz. That means Neil, take somebody's way. Whose way is he going to take? It's pretty obvious. Right. Get rid of that. What sort? Just a second. What sort of animal is Rupert? It's blue, you better get this right.
Bear.
He's a bear, right? Yeah, go on, Carrot, right. Take the weight back. Take the weight back. Ooh, this could go. I'm gonna do this one. Oh, yeah, right. I'm gonna do this one to the audience. What is surrounded by wood in a pencil? It is lead! It is lead! Both of you, throw away, away. They were all right. It is lead. Throw away, away. What is the capital of Australia?
Green.
Green, you better get this right.
Melbourne.
Oh, no, it's Canberra. Throw away, Neil. right. Yes, I think we're going to have a win at any second now. What is Sooty's best friend called? This blue. I hope you get this right.
Sweep.
It is Sweep! Yeah! Oh, yeah! I tell you! Yeah, yeah. Prizes. Come on, Joe. Come on, partner. Who's bringing the prizes on? Yes, thank you. Andrea, how are you? Oh, look, they've got some lovely prizes. You've won a camera and a game. Come this side of me. Come this side so you can get your prizes. They've run a game called Easy Money. All right, well done. Give it to you. Thank you, Andrea. Join again next week for...
I will get them back for that. That went all down my back. Now I know what a baby feels like when it fills its nappy. Oh, it was horrible. Right then, we've got Siobhan and Marcella here from Shakespeare's Sister, and they're going to face the phones. Is that all right, ladies?
Well,
good.
We'll
here
try.
We go for it then. Let's see who we've got on the phone then. Let's have a look. Have we got Tesme there?
Yeah.
Hiya, Tesme. Now, who do you want to put your question to? Do you want to speak to Siobhan? And what is your question? She's having a discussion with her mum here. What's your question, Tesme?
What's your favourite meal?
What's your favourite meal?
My favourite meal?
Yeah.
I'm very fond of egg and chips, actually.
You're an egg and chips lady?
Yeah.
What about fish and chips?
Yeah, I'm fond of that as well.
Anything fancy?
No, anything simple.
She likes the good, solid stuff.
Yeah.
Is that all right, Tesme?
Yeah.
Thanks for phoning. Ta-ra.
Bye.
Al, have you got a question there?
How old were you when you first became interested in music?
What about you, Siobhan?
I think I was probably about 5 or 6. I've been obsessed with it ever since.
Marcella?
When I was really young, I used to love classical music, and I used to dance around the living room playing the Tchaikovsky Nutcracker Suite.
Pretty mixed there. If you grab hold of your phone there, let's see who else we've got on the phone.
All right.
Who have we got here then? Have we got Karen?
Yeah, hello.
Hiya, Karen.
Hi.
What's your question?
I'd like to know, when you formed Shakespeare's Sister, were you worried that you wouldn't be successful? And did you regret leaving Banana Rama?
I think that must be for me.
I guess that's you, Siobhan, yeah.
Well, no, because when the time comes to move on, you got to move on. And I wanted to do something different musically. So I was just excited to do that. And I didn't care about whether it was successful or not, really.
I guess that's a Scouse accent I can hear there, Karen.
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought it was. Is that all right, then?
Yeah.
Thanks a lot. Ta-ra.
Bye.
Got another question here, Sharon?
Why did you leave Bananarama?
Why did I leave? Well, just what I said, I wanted to make a different kind of music.
Again, time to move on.
Yeah.
All right, and who else have we got on the phone there? Have we got Rhea there?
Yes.
Rhea, what's your question?
Who writes your songs?
Who writes your songs?
We do.
I guess it's a bit of teamwork.
Yeah.
Do you write any stuff?
No.
No. Would you like to be a songwriter?
Yes.
Good. Is it easy? Give her a couple of quick tips.
Well, you just have a lot of fun, basically.
Yeah.
Wait for the muse to descend and get cracking.
I've heard a lot of people say that you've got to do something that you can whistle in the bath, something that's nice and catchy.
Not necessarily.
Something mean and moody.
I like things that, yeah.
Well, there's some tips for you. All right, Rhea.
Yeah.
OK, there. We've got another question here.
Bye.
How long did it take to record your first single and video?
Actually, that was one of the first things we recorded, wasn't it? Break My Heart, that was out last year.
Mm-hmm.
And that was recorded very quickly.
Yeah.
And
a few days.
A couple of days, yeah. It was done as a demo, and then we just stuck it out.
Well, thanks for facing the fans. You're going to be playing your history for us any minute now.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's just about the size of it for this week. I'd like to thank all our guests.
Yep.
The girls here and, of course, our studio audience from Norwich.
Yeah! Yeah. Yeah.
You know what? I'll come and join you.
Next week, we're going to be looking at Asterix, the new full-length cartoon, I'm meeting a voice.
Music from next week. I suppose you better go and do your band number for us, actually.
Yeah.
Music next week from Brother Beyond, excuse me, and Fuzzbox. They're going to be joining us next week. Who else have we got next week?
Cliff Richard.
Yes.
Playing tennis with Cliff. We'll leave you with Shakespeare's sister. See you next week.
See you next week.
See ya.
Bye. Bye.
You are.